I want to start us off in our gathering this morning by reminding you of the Hebrew writer's admonition to us. There is so much to be thankful for, so much to be grateful for in the body of Christ. But we also know that because we're living in this life, that when we come to the gathering, we bring with us everything that we are experiencing, everything that we are troubled by, everything that burdens us. And the truth of the matter is that we come to the assembly, we come to the gathering as people in need of a Savior, in need of one another. And so as we begin our gathering this morning, I just want to remind you, Hebrews 10, verse 24, let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. Now that's Hebrews 10, 24 and 25. Now in my English translation, the word day is capitalized. That's a translator's addition. But what the translator is indicating is that this day is not just any day. Mm-hmm. It is a significant day. It is the day of the Lord. That the closer that we draw to the day of Christ's return, we ought to be spurring one another on to love and good deeds. We ought to be meeting together. We ought to be encouraging one another. And that's one of the themes of our gathering today, is we are celebrating that Christ is coming back. We believe it. And so we will sing about it, praise about it, preach about it, encourage one another in it, knowing that when he comes again, God will be glorified and he'll receive us, which has been his eternal invitation all along, for us to be a part of the relational community that has always existed between the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And so as we begin, let's pray. Father, we thank you for this gathering at Common Ground Church. We thank you that you have so blessed us with knowledge of who you are, which continues to grow and fill us. We're grateful for the work that Christ did, your Son, on Calvary. We thank you for the Holy Spirit that lives in us and fills us and is a comforter, is a guarantee, a down payment, a deposit of the work that Christ has done in submission to your will. So we thank you for this opportunity to be together, even distanced, but we gather together heart to heart in the name of Jesus. Would you accept our praise, our worship, our lament? Would you accept the burdens that we bear? We desire to place them at your feet. And would you accept our victorious praise that you continue to live in and through us? We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Common Ground, I want to introduce to you the newest staff member of Common Ground Church, Tessa Vanderkamp. Hey, Tessa, good morning. Good to see you. Excited that you're going to lead us in musical worship this morning. Let's celebrate.
Thank you. reaching far beyond the Milky Way. Let's join in with the sound. Come on, let's sing it out as the music of the universe plays. We're singing, you are holy, great and mighty, the moon and the stars.
Share something that's been on my heart as I prepared for worship this week. Our next song is called The Stand. This song is about surrendering to Christ, giving him all the praise he deserves, giving him our heart. And he gave everything for us. I've just been reflecting on how he gave his life. He conquered death. We've been celebrating Easter with He is Risen. And he came and offered us hope, and he continues to offer that hope as he promised his return. We can have hope each day because he's coming back. And I never want to get tired of waiting, and I always want to offer everything that I have for him. And that's what worship is to me, offering what I can give to him for all that he gave for me. So I just hope that you can join us as we lead you in this next song. Worship in whatever way you're comfortable. You can stand, you can raise your hands, you can dance. However you can raise this next song to him, join us as we sing.
You stood before creation, eternity in your hand. You spoke the earth into motion, my soul now to stand. You stood
every account of Jesus reclining at the table with his disciples, where he takes bread and he takes wine and he gives it to his disciples and he says, take, eat, take and drink, remember me. In every single one of the accounts in the New Testament, in the Greek scriptures, Jesus indicates that when he dies on the cross, his work will not have been finished. He still got some more work to do on our behalf. Even at his resurrection, Jesus rose from the dead. He was raised from the dead, and he went out of his way and found his disciples. He was seen, according to the Apostle Paul, by a whole bunch of folk, over 500 people. And even in his witnessing to them, his talking with them, he says, "My work isn't done." And I grew up hearing this and being taught this and having this instilled in me. And I'm grateful because today I'm absolutely convinced that Christ is coming back. Amen. He's coming back. In a few moments, we're going to celebrate communion together. And if you are prepared to take communion with us today in your location, I ask that you get ready to celebrate with us. The beauty of Zoom is that we can be together visually, and I certainly want to invite you to unmute and celebrate communion with us. I know that I have said that in the last couple of months, and y'all haven't done it, but I still want to invite you to do it anyway. In Matthew 26, Mark chapter 14, Luke 22, 1 Corinthians 11, every single one of these accounts in Scripture has this element of until I come, until the kingdom comes, until my return. I want to read with you Paul's account in 1 Corinthians 11. It's the one that I remember the most growing up. I'm going to read it to you in English Standard Version, but I was taught it in King James Version. I remember it. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, starting at verse 23. "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it, said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, also he took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" I want you to consider doing something a little different this morning. Perhaps you've got a particular kind of bread or a cracker or something that you're using. Right before you take it, would you physically break it? Just as an exercise in doing what Jesus did the night that he was betrayed. That he grabbed bread right off the table and he broke it. Would you actually break it before you eat it? He passed it out to his disciples, his students. And he wanted them to remember him. Now don't forget that Jesus, when he told them to remember me, that he hadn't died yet. Consider that. That means that as they were reclining at the table and they took a piece of bread that Jesus had broken and handed it to them, they had to remember some kind of experience with their rabbi other than the death of Jesus, because he hadn't died yet. Of course, we must remember his death, because his death led to his victorious resurrection. But what do you have to remember today? How Jesus has been with you? how he's been with your family, how he has always shown up, how he's instilled in you the love of the Father, how he's taught you more and more and more about who he is as the Messiah. Maybe there was a time when you felt completely alone and Jesus showed up and he reminded you, I'm never, ever far away from you. I want to just invite you, break the bread and remember Jesus and be confident that as you eat and as you drink, that Jesus' work is not done. He continues to work today. God willing, if he doesn't return tomorrow, he'll be working tomorrow. And we celebrate together. We meet together. We gather together because we are anticipating his return. So let's pray. Tessa is going to lead us in a song. You can sing, you can listen to that song, but during that song, go ahead and eat and drink. Remember Jesus and praise him because he's coming back. Holy Father, we thank you for the bread. We thank you for the wine. And we thank you that you are coming back. Father, Jesus is everything to us because in him is the fullness of the Godhead. And so we thank you that we can celebrate what he has done in and through us. And even the fulfillment of what he did at the cross, which is a completed work in and of itself. Father, we thank you that he's coming back. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Breaking new ground, make me a vessel. I hope that this morning there are hearts excited about the sacrifice that our Lord Jesus Christ has made on our behalf. And as we have this morning altogether participated in the Lord's table, that is a wonderful reminder, a constant reminder about not only Jesus' sacrifice that allows you and I to have eternal life, to live our daily lives in hope. And so we're going to talk about that here in a few minutes. And before we do that, if there are any kids still present, if your kids are with you, this would be the time to go ahead and send them out to the other Zoom link that we have for our children's service. So go ahead and do that. If you need to take a few moments to get your kids, whether they're going to a different room and whatever device they're utilizing to connect, please take a few moments at this time. In addition to that, as I normally stay within my created habits, I don't have any PowerPoint slides for you, but I do have scriptures that we're going to be reading today. And so I would ask that you would take that time as well to grab your Bible, whether that's paper or on your device, whatever your preference is, go ahead and do that at this time as well, because we're going to be reading quite a few verses today. It's so glad to see all of your names here. And then for those of you that are brave enough to turn on your cameras, it's great to see you as well. So I'm glad you are brave. because it allows me to feel a little more brave as well. And within the comfort of where you are, don't be afraid to say amen. You know, when you hear the words of Jesus and we read scripture, please don't be shy. You know, all that we do, including this time, is to honor our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So even if I can't hear you, that doesn't matter. What matters is that Christ knows you. He knows your heart, and that he knows how excited you are about his word and his work in your life. So hopefully that was enough time for you. Today, we're going to be reading in Matthew chapter 25, verses 1 through 13. And so what I would like to do today is actually begin with verse 13. That is Matthew 25, verse 13. If you can take time to get there, and please be patient with me today, as I have other verses as well that I'm going to be reading. I hope that I have them all well marked so that I'm just going there quickly, but if not, I would greatly appreciate you being patient with me. So let's start in Matthew 25, verse 13. Verse 13 says the following: "Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know the day or the hour." See, this verse is so exciting. And at the same time, creates a little challenge for me. I don't know about you, right? Because keep watch, what does that mean? What is Jesus getting at? And then, because you do not know the day or the hour. See, there are things in the experience of human existence that will impact the way that we go about in life, right? And the way in which your life is influenced can vary from slightly little to being greatly impacted or profoundly impacted. Jesus said, "You do not know the day." I will say that again. "You do not know the day or the hour." Therefore, because you did not know, keep watch. See, this morning, we're going to be taking a closer look at Matthew 25, verses 1 through 12, as we've already mentioned. And let's start actually reading all those 12 verses. And then as we go through, we're going to be focusing in on the verses specifically. So if you can follow along with me, you don't have to read. You can just listen to me, but do follow along. At that time, the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 virgins that took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. Five of them were foolish and five were wise. The foolish ones took their lamps, but did not take any oil with them. The wise ones, however, took oil in jars along with their lamps. The bridegroom was a long time coming, and they all became drowsy and fell asleep. At midnight, the cry rang out, "Here is the bridegroom, come out to meet him." Then all the virgins woke up and trimmed their lamps. The foolish ones said to the wise, "Give us some of your oil, our lamps are going out." "No," they replied, "there may not be enough for both of us and you. Instead, go to those who sell oil and buy some for yourselves." But while they were on their way to buy the oil, the bridegroom arrived. The virgins who were ready went in with him to the wedding banquet, and the door was shut. Later, the others also came. "Lord, Lord," they said, "open the door for us." But he replied, "Truly I tell you, I don't know you. Truly I tell you, I don't know you. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know the day or the hour." What was Jesus speaking about? Of which we simply just do not know the day nor the hour. We're going to be looking at that question today. And we will also seek to gain a deeper understanding of Jesus' words to therefore keep watch. So let's start with what we do not know. Verse 1, there is something that we do not know. At that time, the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 virgins that took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. So we do not know the day nor the hour. And that was explained to us in verse 13. And that is why I actually began there, to identify what it is that we do not know. You with me so far? You see, Jesus is saying, you do not know the specifics of that time. And so naturally, my question is, well, what time, Lord? What time are you speaking about? A couple of weeks ago, Dr. Tim Robnett gave us an introduction to chapter 24 of Matthew. And I will actually like to go there, verse 36 of the 24th chapter of Matthew, verse 36. This is what it reads. "But about the day or hour, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. As it was in the days of Noah, so it will be at the coming of the Son of Man." See, about the second coming of Jesus, not only do we, the church, does not know, but the angels do not know, and even Jesus himself does not know either. And so that time is only known by the Father who is in heaven, according to the verse that we just read, verse 36. Again, that time is only known by the Father who is in heaven. And it is not for you nor for me to know the day nor the hour. So that's what we don't know. What do we know, though? What have we learned in just these verses so far? Well, we do know that Jesus is coming back for his church. No, wait. Let me say that again. Jesus is coming back for his church. Can you say amen to that? You know, what will my heart do? What will my body do? How will I respond? Is that going to get me to say hallelujah, glory, amen? I don't know about you, but if this doesn't fill me with joy, I don't know what else will. See, I like to think that I'm not too much of an emotional guy. I think maybe most of us guys don't want to see ourselves as an emotional person, right? Yeah, we're not really connected with our emotions. However, there are some things that get me pretty excited. I like sports. One of the sports that I like is boxing. Probably gonna think, man, Brother Juan is a brute. That's a lot of violence. You may be right, but I love a good match where pugilistic abilities are going to be on showcase. I just love it. And I get excited, all right? I try to hold back my emotions, my passion, but every once in a while, they just flourish. They just happen naturally. And so I am wondering, when we think about Jesus' return, does our body respond in the same way? Because that is a whole lot more than somebody's pugilistic abilities on display. There is plenty to say about that as well. If that's where your mind goes, there's also plenty to say that. I don't know all the eschatology topics and details, so we're not going to get into that. All I'm going to say is that, man, if I am thinking about the return of my Lord and Savior, I'm going to shout amen. And so, can we, the church, be excited about our Lord's return? Let us go back to our scripture reading today, verse 2 through 6. 2 through 6. Five of them were foolish, and five were wise. The foolish ones took their lamps, but did not take any oil with them. The wise ones, however, took oil in jars along with their lamps. The bridegroom was a long time in coming, and they all became drowsy and fell asleep. At midnight, the cry rang out, "Here is the bridegroom, come out to meet him." See, in this verse, one of the things that I love about it is, and I'm sure that you've already caught on to the fact, but have you noticed the language? And what I mean by that is there is language here about a bridegroom in this parable. Now, hold on here. This is just me thinking, okay? If you ask me, the topic of Jesus' return for his church and then marriage, a wedding, I'll just be honest with you. To me, the two just don't mix. And so I'm already being a little challenged here. I was like, what does the return have to do with marriage? Like, they have nothing in common. That's at first glance. That's what I am thinking. But this is how Jesus actually approached communicating it. And so, you know what? I would trust that he, Jesus, definitely knows exactly how to best convey this message. that, hey, you are my church. You are my followers. I'm about to leave, but I will come back. I will come back for you. Matter of fact, if you were to go to John 3, verse 26 through 29. This is a really interesting passage because what we have here is there is an argument. There's an argument between the followers of John the Baptist and a certain Jew. Now, this passage does not drop a name. And so due to that, I will keep that person's identity in secret. Not because I want to, because I've got no other choice. That person shall continue nameless. But there's an argument here. And so verse 26 gives us this instance. And so I said I had it well marked. And so thank you for being patient with me today. John 3, verse 26. Found it. They came to John and said to him, Rabbi, that man who was with you on the other side of the Jordan, the one you testified about, look, he is baptizing, and everyone is going to him. Verse 27, to this, John replied, a person can receive only what is given them from heaven. You yourselves can testify that I said, I am not the Messiah, but I am sent ahead of him. The bride belongs to the bridegroom. The friend who attends the bridegroom waits and listens for him. And then check this out, and is full of joy when he hears the bridegroom's voice. That joy is mine, and it is now complete. This is John the Baptist talking about and identifying Jesus as this bridegroom who was expected. And he is saying, I, as his friend, you know, all I can do is have great joy. And because I have witnessed the bridegroom, then my joy is complete. Church, where are we? Come on, follower of Jesus Christ. If you are a disciple, where are we? Is your joy complete? Am I living out that joy that Jesus brings to those who are awaiting his return, those who have placed all their trust and all their hope in Jesus Christ, those who have made a decision, Jesus, you are my treasure. And because you are my treasure, nothing else matters to me. Everything tends to lose value in my perspective. And so here I am. Everything that I am is now yours. I am yours. And you are mine. So this is what John the Baptist says. And there are other verses that identify. Matter of fact, Jesus himself speaks about himself as the bride. We're not going to go through all those verses. However, I do have a few that I do want to give you so that you can jot them down. And then later on, make the time, give yourself the opportunity to go to those verses and read it from Jesus' very own words about, hey, I am the bridegroom. So one of the verses that I have for you is Matthew 9, verse 15. Matthew 9, verse 15. I also have Mark chapter 2, 19 through 20. And then the third and final one, there are more. I did not do an extensive search. There are more. And so Ephesians 5, verses 25 through 32. Ephesians 5, 32. So, to recap, what do we not know is the day nor the hour of the second coming of Jesus. But in giving assurance about his imminent return, and Jesus was actually proposing, he was trying to comfort his followers in giving them assurance about his return. And to do this, Jesus uses an imagery that is well understood by his audience. And I will guess that as Jesus' audience expands beyond that of his disciples and those who were actually listening audibly to him at that time, I will guess that some will perceive Jesus' words an accessible invitation, while others will experience a powerful repellent by Jesus' words. So Jesus' audience at that time was fully aware that when two people are given in marriage, see, this is the part where to me it was like, yeah, they don't mix, but hear this out. The audience at that time, they were fully aware. They knew culturally. Their understanding of Jesus' words was better connected to his words than we are, because not only are we bound by time, we live in a different culture. And so time and cultures tend to have an impact about or on the way in which we do same things. And one of those things is marriage. We see marriage, we treat marriage, and we also practice marriage in a different way. But the audience of Jesus at that time had a good understanding of Jesus' words. And in reality, marriage was or is a perfect example of what Jesus is talking about, that, hey, I am coming back. I am coming back for my church. There are many details about marriage that we're not going to get into this morning. And we will only discuss those which help us understand Jesus' return for his church. Given that this wedding, so back then you wanted to marry at that time, what was the norm is you would get your father to go see the father of that young lady, or vice versa, the young lady, which I don't think, see, again, I highly doubt that would happen often, because the norm was that the young man would take the initiative. In today's culture, that isn't the case, right? There are times where women are way more brave than men and they take the first step. But at that time, the young man would get his father to go see the father of the young lady and ask for this young lady's hand in marriage. Thus, that is how it took place. And so given that the proposal was accepted, this young man would then return to his home. And this newly engaged couple would go for about a full year before they were actually united in marriage. Again, I understand that that probably doesn't make a whole lot of sense. Our culture today is quite different in practice and in how we see marriage. But that's how it happened. So we're talking about a full year. My understanding is that not only was it a full year, but quite often there was no communication between the two. It wasn't as a, hey, I'm going to go visit my girlfriend. We're going to chat. We're going to hang out. Matter of fact, quite often, the way that they would communicate there usually was a friend. And this friend would relay messages here and there. But there was no direct communication between the two, for a full year. This is a person that you are about to spend the rest of your life with. How hard can that be? How challenging can that be? Well, his listeners, his audience understood this. This time of 1 year without direct communication was very important. Why is that? Well, you see, when the young man returned home after asking for the hand in marriage, he would have a great purpose upon his return to his home. By the way, they were usually living at his parents' house, all right? And so the bridegroom would prepare their home. That could have been a completely new home somewhere on the father's property. Quite often, it was a room within the father's home. But that was his main task, to prepare what would be their home as a newlywed couple at a later time. And likewise, the bride would also prepare for what would be their life together. They would, both of them would prepare for their new life together. Now, let's stop here for a minute, because I think in today's culture, when and that is to include marriage, and it's not, it doesn't only apply in marriage. I think that today, quite often, we live in experiences where, you know, my word doesn't count as much. But I can say, hey, yep, I would do this. I commit to this. And my word would not have as much value. Sadly enough, that includes marriage in our culture, that we haven't truly valued what marriage is and why God created it, and why God says this is good, and this is something I'm giving you for your enjoyment. See, that part of commitment. Matter of fact, even at that time, at the time of Jesus, it had already become regular practice for men to be married, and for whatever reason, you know, maybe the wife burnt the water a little too much, and he would put her away, right? Because you can't have that. You cannot be burning the water, right? And so, you know what? I'm going to put you away. I'm going to find somebody else, and I'm going to marry that person. This was happening. This was sort of had already become regular practice. And so when Jesus conveys this message of I am coming back to his audience, he uses marriage because he wants to get the point across. It wasn't about him. It was about his audience understanding exactly what Jesus means and the commitment that he has for this promise that I will come back for you. Even though at that point, we had already lost that commitment into marriage. John 14, 2-3 gives us Jesus' words when it comes to that. So if you can go there with me, John 14, 2-3. And this is what Jesus wants for us to fully understand. This is his commitment. This is his promise. Verse 2. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, so that you also may be where I am. See, this is exactly what Jesus is trying to get his audience to understand. Today, Jesus is interested. He wants that you and I understand that I am coming back. And so, yes, utilize this imagery of marriage, because you as a human being have experienced this, that you went and got engaged. And then after that, you went back home and you prepared a home for your bride. And Jesus is saying, well, in the same exact way, I am committed to go home and I'm preparing a place for you, but I will come back for you just like you have learned to do, even when you have lost your way about marriage. I need you to understand that I do not lose my way about it, that I am coming back for you. Now, I don't know, church, but man, that gives me goosebumps. That makes me excited about being the church of Christ, about being seen by Jesus as his bride. I love this verse because, man, somebody is preparing a place for me. Somebody is preparing a home for me. And so when this is all done, what a great joy, what a hope that this isn't it. That no matter how much I can accumulate, Jesus is preparing a place for me. Let's go to verse 5. Let's go back to our original verse, Matthew 25, verse 5. We're almost done. Don't worry. Verse 5. The bridegroom was a long time in coming, and they all became drowsy and fell asleep. Notice, though, the bridegroom delayed in his return. The bridegroom was a long time in coming, as this verse says. And while the delay, these virgins became drowsy and they fell asleep. While Jesus delays, many of us will fall asleep. You and I will likely fall asleep. You staying with me? You know what I'm saying? You understand what I'm saying? That it is highly likely that you and I are going to fall asleep. And I don't just mean the sleep that we wake up on our own in the morning when that loud alarm goes off, right? And try to throw it across the room so it can leave us alone and we can get a couple more minutes of some good sleep. Yeah, that's not what I mean. I'm talking about you and I are going to fall asleep, from which we will not be awakened until when? Well, until that midnight hour, until that cry is given out, the bridegroom is here. See, when the cry rings out, when the midnight hour hits, those sleeping will be awakened. Come out to meet him. I don't know about you, but that is glorious. Just, I cannot even begin to comprehend the fact that I'm going to pass away. That actually makes me sad, because I know that I'm going to miss many things. But when I think about the fact that, hey, you know what? It is all well. Jesus is coming back. And when he does, I will be awakened. And I will come out and I will meet him. Does that excite you? Church, does that give you excitement? Does that give you hope? Does that make you joyous about tomorrow? That regardless of what happens, I know that I'm going to be okay. Let's go to verses 7 and 10. so we can finish up today. 7 and 10. Then all the virgins woke up and trimmed their lamps. The foolish ones said to the wise, give us some of your oil. Our lamps are going out. No, they replied, there may not be enough for both of us, for both us and you. Instead, go to those who sell oil and buy some for yourselves. But while they were on their way to buy the oil, the bridegroom arrived. The virgins who were ready went in with him to the wedding banquet, and the door was shut. Here we get to a difficult part. Those who were ready, they got to go in. And after they went in, the door was shut. I don't know if you've noticed that. Those who were ready, they had two things. They had a lamp with them, and they also had a jar of oil. And I know that doesn't make a whole lot of sense to us today, right? Because we got electricity. We got solar lights and LED lights and all kinds of lights. And we're not concerned about how dark it is outside because the city does a decent job at providing lighting just about everywhere. I am sure there are some spots that is not the case, but for the most part, that is the case. That was not how things worked for people out in those days. And so I know that we could get into a whole lot of, explaining the oil, the lamp, and all those things. Here's what I really want you to understand is that this is basically like, I love camping. And if I'm ready to go camping, I need to have a light because the areas that I like going camping at just don't have light. Sometimes they don't even have a restroom, right? With hot water and everything else that I usually like to have in a restroom. And so when I get ready to go camping, I'm going to have a light. That may mean I need to have some kerosene. That may mean I need to have some batteries. I may need to have those little mantles that dissolve once you touch them after they burn for my lamp. I cannot just take the lamp and say, I'm ready. Gotta have the source that will allow that lamp to work. And see, what this means for us is to be ready. That we must be ready for this return of Jesus. See, back then, what the listener at that time was understanding when Jesus says this is that after a year of waiting, this bridegroom would again go to the house of this young lady, the girlfriend, in our culture today, not only would he go, but there were friends, family members who would accompany him to the house of his bride-to-be. And so they got an invitation. Somehow they got an invitation, but they had no idea when this bridegroom would go. Most of the time, it seemed like culturally it happened after dark, sometime in the wee hours of night. And so because they had no lighting, like we do in today's world that we live in, what they would do is people would stay ready. Those who were invited, they would stay ready. That means that they had a lamp, and the ones that were ready actually had some extra oil. And what would happen is as this young man was walking to the house of his loved one, the bride-to-be, is that the people that he invited were awake, and they were waiting. And what they would need to look for is a light in the midst of a dark town, a dark city. And as long as they saw the light, they knew that it was time. They joined this enclave, this group going to the bride to be to her house. And that once they would reach there, they would also have a banquet. But the point was, is that if you were to be ready, because you were gonna join the bridegroom, is that you really needed to have your lamp and your oil so that when you saw those lights in the dark town, that you could join that group and actually make it. That is why lamps and oils are mentioned here. And so let's go to verse 11 and 12. Later, the others also came. Lord, Lord, they said, open the door for us. But he replied, truly I tell you, I don't know you. Herein, in verse 12, lies both the problem and the solution. You see, for some, the grave problem in all their life is going to be that Jesus says, I never knew you. I don't know you. See, it may be possible that we've been hanging out with religious people because we love the idea of being in some sort of a party, some sort of a banquet. It may be multiple reasons, right? I like all the benefits that are to be had from being in close vicinity to this bridegroom. But you know what? The reality is that I am not fully, wholeheartedly interested in the bridegroom. See, for those who are following all the events that are happening, those whose heart are truly focused on the bridegroom, those are the ones that are ready. If all your hope is set on Jesus Christ and not everything else that comes with it, with this experience, look, I love being with the brothers and sisters in Christ. But the reality is that I am there because of Christ. I am there for Christ, knowing you, being in relationship with you, counting on you as my brother and my sister, it's a great benefit. But the reality, I am here because of my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And I want to challenge you today. What is it that keeps you on watch? Is it to be in the party? Is it to be surrounded by people that you may like, people that may support you? Is it because of all the things Jesus has to offer, but not Jesus himself? See, that is why I say herein in verse 12 lies the problem and the solution. Let me read that again. Truly, I tell you, I don't know you. You see, the solution is to not only know Jesus in a personal way, but that Jesus himself, the bridegroom, knows you in a personal way. See, he already knows you because he created you, but he wants to have a personal relationship with you. He's not happy. He's not looking forward to just be part of that crowd that's surrounded because there's going to be a party and I want to be there. I want to see what happens. No. He wants you to be there for him. He wants to have commitment with you. He wants to be in a committed relationship with you. He wants to take you home so that you can live. But this life will be together in his presence, in the presence of Almighty God, the Father. Will you be ready? Listen, you cannot make yourself ready. The only way you're going to be ready is when Jesus makes you ready. You say, well, how does that happen? What do you mean by being ready? Here's what I mean. If you've heard the name of Jesus Christ, and if you've heard this talk about, man, I am a sinner, that I have done wrong, and the Holy Spirit has convicted you. You know what? There is truth to that. And you're able to arrive at a place where you're saying, Lord Jesus, you're right. I am a sinner. And I need you. I need your forgiveness. But here I am. I give you all my life. I want you. And if you're saying that you're willing to forgive me, well, Lord, here I am. If you've done that, maybe you've never done that. But as you're listening today and you're saying, huh, I'm interested about that. You know what? Jesus is more interested in you because he's been chasing after you for quite some time. Would you respond? Would you accept that invitation? Would you go from being repelled to Jesus' words to actually perceiving an invitation. If that is you today, I would encourage you to take some time today. Enclose yourself in your room, wherever you can have some privacy, and talk to Jesus. Because you know what? It's coming back for his church. And if you are ready, you get to go in and you get to be known by Christ himself in the Father. If that is you today, please send a text. You can send it to Pastor Avery. I know that any of the other leaders within Common Ground would love to hear from you if that is your case. If you need to talk to someone about that, if you don't know, you're unclear how to do that, because I just wasn't clear today, I am sure that there are many brothers and sisters who would love to have a chat with you about that. God bless you.
I think that I might be lagging a little bit on Zoom, or at least that it appears that I am. Somebody give me the thumbs up if you can understand me right now. Okay. I just want to say amen to that message. It just means I agree. If we were all in the same room together, I would just invite people to respond with an amen, but just so grateful to be reminded in the music that we sang and the prayers that we prayed in our time around the Lord's table and in this message that he's coming back. We hang out together. We love one another. We commit to one another. We spend time together in small community. We gather together because he's coming back. He's coming back. It's a public witness to what we know is true, and that Jesus is coming. And so I'm just so grateful for today and our time together. Next Sunday, we'll be gathering at Parkside Fellowship, 11 o'clock. We want to remind you, in case you forgot, or maybe you never knew, our 11 o'clock is not just our new COVID time, but it's our new gathering time. And so 11 o'clock, begin now to anticipate gathering together. If you are physically able to do that and you are emotionally comfortable with doing that, then we certainly invite you to gather with us. We'll mask up, we'll social distance. We will have more hand sanitizer than you could ever use in one setting, and we'll provide that for you. God willing, anticipating Tessa leading worship live and in stereo. And God willing, I'll preach the word next Sunday and be closing out our series in the parables of Jesus. And it'll be Mother's Day. How about that? And I'm grateful to be able to be together live and in stereo on Mother's Day. And for those of you that'll continue to be at home, you'll be able to join us also on Zoom. And even as I'm talking, I can see in my peripheral vision over here sitting on the couch in my living room, this beautiful woman of God. And her name is Adela Stafford. She's mom, and she's here in the room. She's in the room. So praise God. We'll be able to worship with mom next Sunday. This afternoon, the youth are meeting. You see that, mom? It says, hi, Mama Stafford. Oh. That's from Evan. Evan, man, that's Jen's husband. I'm sorry, I'm doing the interpretation, and y'all are listening. Yeah. Oh, that is from Jen, who's using the computer or the device that says even man. If that made sense, then you are a better person than I am. All right. Want to thank you for gathering together today. Youth are gathering at Parkside. No, that's not true. Youth are online today. That is correct. Woo, let me say that again. Youth, if you show up to Parkside, you better have some device to get on Zoom in the car, because youth will be gathering online today in Jesus' name. I put up the church's telephone number. If If you want to respond to the message or the gathering today, God, perhaps he moved you in a way that you want to respond, you feel free to send us a text. And we'd love to partner with you in saying, yay, God, for what he's doing, or to partner with you for whatever might be burdening you or struggling, a struggle in your life. We want you to respond.
Good afternoon, Common Ground Church. You know, as a church family, one of the things we do is to support one another when times are tough. And another thing we do is to support one another when times are good. So this past Friday, we had a good time. Friday evening, we had a good time. Because Friday evening was the time when Pastor Avery was awarded the Doctor of Ministry degree. So let's all give Avery a hand on that. And so Avery, I know you don't want this, or maybe you're not comfortable with this, but sorry, we want to recognize your achievement. We took some pictures that we would like to share with the congregation, and Carrie will cue that up. What I'd like to do is afterwards, we'll pray for you, and then we could have Juan do the final blessing and dismissal. So, Carrie, if you want to share that PowerPoint we put together. So, Avery, on behalf of Common Ground Church, congratulations on your achievement. And I think let's all do a reaction, but that's right. Let's clap on our reactions, and so we can capture that. That's great. So let me go ahead and pray for Avery and the Stafford family, and then Juan, I'll turn it over to you. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you and praise you for blessing Avery with the degree, Doctor of Ministry degree, this past Friday evening. And Father, we praise you for giving him the perseverance, the wisdom, and the discipline to complete that degree, Father. We also praise you for Nina and the Stafford family for the encouragement. And the help that they gave Avery as he was pastoring Common Ground Church. Father, we lift Avery up to you. We pray that you would give him wisdom and guidance as he uses his work on church collaboration to further your kingdom. We just thank you and praise you for Avery's degree. And we lift this up to you in your son's name, Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Congratulations, Avery.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this time that we've been able to enjoy your word, Father. We thank you because you are so gracious to us. But we thank you because we've had this great opportunity to get a better understanding of your promise, of your commitment to us. We thank you for your son, Jesus Christ, Heavenly Father, who not only has made as ready by the shedding of his blood on his cross, as we were reminded today by participating in your table, on your table. Father, we love you and we thank you for that. We praise you. We want to worship you all the days of our lives for what you've done on our behalf. And Father, we're excited. We are overjoyed. We are hopeful to the fact, to the reality that a lot of times you can't even comprehend fully that you are coming back, that you will come back for your church, for those who love you, for those who trust you. Help us, Father, to be living every day to that expectation, that as you've made us ready, that we'll stay ready, anxiously looking forward for when that time comes, because we want to see you, we want to be with you, we want to be risen, we want to be awakened by your mighty power. We ask all these things in the most precious and beautiful name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Everyone, be blessed. Live out the joy and thank Jesus today for his sacrifice. See you next week.